What's happening, guys? It's Adam here. Just before we go into this week's episode, I want to let you know that we do an extra episode of this shit every single week exclusively on Patreon. If you don't know what Patreon is, it's basically a way for you to financially support this podcast while getting a few rewards for yourself. Now, you can sign up for £3 a month, £5 a month, or £10 a month. The more money you give us, the more benefits you get. But even the people who only sign up for £3 a month, which is what, less than the price of a fancy coffee, you get an extra episode every single week, which is about an hour and a half long, where it's just me and Dan most of the time. You also get early access to these public episodes with the guests. You get discounts on merch, discounts on live shows, early access to tickets for stuff like that. And also, you get access to every single Patreon episode we've already done as soon as you sign up. There's a shitload of stuff there. It's a massive back catalogue. We've been doing this for months now. Sign up today at patreon.com/haveawordpod. The link is in the description. Subscribe to this channel while you're there. Give us a little like on the video and let's get to the podcast.
So you were saying you hate Runcorn and you want to move the studio to somewhere more palatable.
Hey! Hey, Runcorn! Wasn't saying that. Just saying it looks like your town planner had a stroke mid-town plan. It looks like he's going, and I put a railway station there, and then just fucking went everywhere. It's mental.
If it does feel like the place Liverpool has sent all its unwanted people to me.
Right.
Yeah, like I've said this before, the least attractive people in the world live in Runcorn.
Yeah. It's a weird town, man. It's honestly a weird, and there's some nice houses, but I know they're mega cheap. You know that type of vibe. When you look at a house, you go, that's a nice house. I bet that's worth nothing.
Yeah. You must look at Runcorn and be like, listen, what am I going to do? Yeah. Am I going to do 2-bed flat in North London, or am I going to do this fucking hospital that I could just buy and live in like a king?
Yeah, yeah. But in Runcorn.
Yeah.
You're the king of sand at that point, isn't it?
Whenever I tell a comic in London what I pay. So I live on my own in a 3-bedroom house in Liverpool. Mm. And I pay less than most comics play for a fucking cupboard in a house shared.
It's crazy.
In Kensington.
It's actually, but then it's the same thing of like, you know, like not Liverpool ain't bad. I'm not shitting on Liverpool by any stretch of imagination, but it's not London, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I think that's...
I'd rather live in Liverpool, me though.
Yeah, that's because, you know, even the way you... Yeah. Of course, with that accent though. Like, we're me though. Like, you know, that's obviously a voice of a guy who wants to live in Liverpool. No, I like up north. I think I lived in Manchester and that. Like, I get it.
Yeah.
You know, it's a nice town. I'd live here again. But, you know, for what you're paying in London, it isn't. I'm born and raised London. I'm starting to think it's not worth it.
Yeah.
Where's your option then? Not if it's not Runcorn, I'm not going to do London anymore. What are you going to do? What
Manchester.
Are you going
to?
Yeah?
Yeah. Or I just go somewhere wild and shit. Just go Switzerland. Fuck it. Let's go Amsterdam. I think about going to Amsterdam once when I was like about 24. I thought about going to Amsterdam, but I realized for me to pay rent, I would have to fly back to England 5 days a week.
There are comics that do that, not from Amsterdam, because I think you might miss a few flights if you live in Amsterdam. Like, I've got a weekend in Edinburgh, but I fucking missed it by 6 days. Damn you, Amsterdam, with your local produce.
Yeah, Ian Moore lives in Paris, doesn't he? And he commutes back and forth.
He doesn't live in Paris. Yeah, he lives in like a farmland in France. Like, he lives out there. It's not even like he lives in metropolitan.
I can imagine you living in Amsterdam. You love Amsterdam. You love the comedy club there, don't you? Too,
yeah, man. Yeah, yeah. But I can only play there maybe once or twice a year.
Yeah.
And that doesn't pay. Like, you know,
wouldn't even pay my rent.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's not like, oh, I do a gig there and it's 40 grand. Like, it's, you know, it's just club money.
Yeah, and if you think industry don't come to Liverpool and Runcorn, they're probably not coming to Amsterdam.
Yeah. I don't know, but up north, I think Manchester's the only one. I couldn't live in Birmingham.
No, Manchester's good for you, like under normal circumstances for UK comedians, because it's actually right in the middle of the whole country. If you include Scotland as the country,
yeah,
which we shouldn't because they're independent, but
not yet. It's coming though.
It's right. It's so easy to get to everywhere. Everywhere is like 2 hours away, isn't it?
Well, I lived in Manchester for 10 years, and it was handy as fuck. I only pussied out just because I got old and wanted to be like, I want a garden. But it is.
And
it
you've
is.
Now moved to one of the only cities in the UK that doesn't have a comedy club.
Well, yeah, that's true. But I'm 40 minutes away from every gig in the Northwest, aren't you? That's the thing. If you live in the Northwest, really, like, London is so sprawling and so difficult to get round. Apart from, like, obviously there's the underground and everything. But if you lived in Runcorn, you're as handy for Liverpool, Manchester, all of the gigs in the Northwest as you would be living in any part of London, getting to gigs in London. It's like, that's the trade-off, isn't it? As long as you've got a fucking car,
yeah,
but you can get all around the Northwest really easy.
It's quality of life, though, isn't it? Because, like, you could get
seven-bedroom house for 300 quid a month.
But it's like you're, you know, just to get to gigs in the Northwest.
Like, I know.
Like, oh, yeah, I could get to a gig in Chester. Fuck. Getting to a gig at Chester,
you want to live in London with all the culture?
Yeah, I can make
Warrington in 23 minutes. Come on, Jamali, think about it.
That is 20-minute gig, and I don't really want a gig in Warrington anyway. Right.
If you move to Manchester, you fucking will, my friend. Yeah, you'll be like Warrington. You'll be doing all of the shit Northwest comedy. Like, who's drinking?
When I lived in Manchester, I couldn't get any work in the Northwest.
Did you start in Manchester?
No, I started in London, but I moved to Manchester because I heard there was all this gig in the Northwest. And nobody wanted to book me. So I kept on having to get the train back from London.
So you were commuting back to London?
Yeah.
To get London gigs?
To do weekend spots at Comedy Caf.
What? Why weren't you getting work?
I love the Caf, you know. Did you do the Comedy Cafe?
Never done the Comedy Caf.
No, Faulkner. He was crazy, man. Yeah. He's a legend. He's like an Irish guy.
I've mentioned him on the podcast before on the very first Steph episode. So right now we're talking about Noel. I can smell his breath. Do you know what I mean? He had a very distinctive... And he had a bit of a click. He'd done too many drugs and he was just a bit
dead sound. Yeah, born like that.
Yeah,
got,
was he?
He's got, what's it called? What's the thing? With Tourette's.
Was he really?
Yeah, Tourette's.
I thought it was a drug thing.
No, it's Tourette's. Oh, I bet he did do a lot of drugs. I don't want to speak his thing, but I think it's out there. He used to do he got kicked out of America or some shit he was doing drug running or some shit.
Yeah.
He's like a boat guy.
That's not a good thing to, when you've got Tourette's, you don't think drug running. You know, when you've got like 9 kilos of cocaine in the back of a car, be like, fuck, come, fuck, shit.
He was a good dude, man. I remember he was a mad guy. I remember one time he booked me for weekends and I didn't have 20 minutes. And I said to him, I've only got 40 minutes. Where he goes, well, you better sort it out. You're on next. And I came back the next week.
Get your pad out.
Yeah.
Quick 6 minutes.
And I came back the next week and I was like, you know what? I think I've got a 20 now. He goes, good, you're closing. And he made me close gigs.
Oh my God.
And I love shit like that though. Like I was like, he booked me. So I'd emailed like everyone. I was trying to get London gigs without ever doing the open mic circuit in London. And I had a couple. I got in Top Secret quite early. I got really lucky with how I got in there. But I emailed him and was like, and I sent this full, when you start out, you send this full fucking life story email, don't you?
Yeah.
I started here. I won the
flying pig competition. Yeah.
And I can wear shoes really well. And I know places and colours. It's really like,
I got to the clap off of Barry Chuckle Hunt's gong show last week. And his massive life story. And he replied and said, I like people from Liverpool. Scousers are funny. Yet you're in. And he put me in for a weekend just because I was Scouse.
Yeah, and he would do stuff. I mean, one time I was there and someone was talking about shitting on stage and he goes, he'll never work my club again. And I go, why? He goes, because he's talking about shitting. You don't talk about shitting in my club. And he's wearing blue jeans. And I go, I'm wearing blue jeans. And he goes, yeah, but it's different. So that was his logic and that was it.
It's funny when you don't like someone's comedy or them, how you just find reasons to be pissed off with them. But as soon as you like someone, you're like, yeah, he just pooed on the stage. But that closing bit's fucking great.
One of the few, like we've talked a lot about comedy on the 90 odd episodes we've done of this. We haven't really delved into the world of fucking crazy promoters because there's so many promoters who are just a bit Noel's one of them. One of my favourite clubs, which is the one I see you at the most now, is Top Secret Comedy Club in London.
Mark Rothman,
which you've mentioned. Mark's amazing, but he's fucking mental. This is how
who runs it?
Mark Rothman isn't it his name. And he compares it. He does the bar.
always the sign, the first sign of the mental promoter, isn't it? Like, I don't need a compare. I'll compare. Well,
he started the club to get gigs because no one was booking him. Now grown into one of the best comedy clubs in the fucking world. He does the bar. He shoos the smokers away from his door. He does the sound. He does the voice. He does everything. Mark's like...
He builds shit in there as well. Like, he built the toilets.
Yeah. You know, like Binti at Hot Water?
Yeah.
It's like if Binti compared and did the bar. He's like Bugs Bunny. He's everywhere. You've seen that episode of Friends where it's like, first big Alan, you know that? Like he's just all like you look everywhere. Like he's on the bar.
He wears a hat at the bar. You know what I'm saying? It's always a different character. Yeah, yeah.
But I got into Top Secret when it was in the Africa Centre, which first venue.
What?
There's a place in London in Covent Garden called the Africa Centre, and they had a room in there.
What a random place to start.
I was in London to do a tryout at Sway for Jonglers, right? And I just walked past Top Secret, and I was like, I just popped my head in, say that I'm a comic. I was only like 2 years in. I was like, I'll just say I'm a comic. And just wondering how to get spots. So I popped my head in and went to, hey, mate, you're all right? I'm Adam, I'm a comedian. He was like, yeah. Move out the way. And I was like, what? And he goes, I've got customers, just get in. So I was like, right. And then he cleared the queue and I went, yeah, so nice to meet you. My name's Adam, I'm a comic. He went, yeah. Have I booked you? And I went, no. And he went, oh, so why are you here? And so I was just coming to introduce myself and I'm doing Jonglers tonight around the corner. He went, are you doing Jonglers? Oh, do you want to get on? And I went, yeah, go on then. So before I went and did Jonglers, I just accidentally did this gig at Top Secret. And then I had a really good gig and he came up and he went, send us your dates. What have you got? And he got his laptop out and he's like, yeah, so when do you want to come back? And I was like, in 3 weeks. And he was like, yeah.
But by the way, if you're a young comic trying to make your way in the game, that's not usually how it goes. Don't be like, oh, that's what I've been doing wrong. I've been emailing people. What I'll do is just turn up. Be like, hi, Comedy Store. Can I get on?
Yeah, it's just mad.
I love that story. And I love the fact, you want a gig for gigs like The Glee, which is very professional. The Store, very professionally run. But you love the nutcases. The nutcases make it exciting. Like that guy, yeah, it obviously sounds a bit mental, but he's got one of the most successful clubs in the country, and that shit's adorable, isn't it?
And his stairway, if you go down the stairs to get into the Top Secret, now it's just every photo on the wall is like a huge celebrity that's played it. So like Jamali's on the wall. There's like...
It gets better from there.
Huge. Huge.
It gets better from there, don't worry.
And all the other people who've turned up and said hello.
Yeah, it gets better from there, don't worry. It does, it's a better lift than
there's
that.
There's John Bishop, Chowdhury, Amy Schumer, Eliza Schlesinger, Michelle Wolf. Like, they've had everyone drop in. And occasionally, like, I've turned up there before to close and gone, who's been on? And they've gone, oh, Paul Chowdhury opened, Jack Whitehall's just in the middle. Have a good gig. Right?
Okay.
But one night, so this is... He just, if someone's in town from America, he wants them on the wall. So do you know who TJ Miller is? Have you seen Deadpool? Yeah. You know the bartender?
Yeah.
So that's TJ Miller. He's a stand-up.
Yeah.
So he goes to me, I'm due to close, and he goes, right, TJ Miller wants to come down. It's Jack Whitehall's mate. So he's put him in touch, and he's going to go on after you've closed. We're just going to say, oh, I've got a special guest. So just do 10 minutes and wrap up. And then we'll get TJ, because he'll be here in a minute. So just get you on, you do 10. And then TJ got it. So I go on stage and I get 10 minutes in and I go, right, guys, that's just my time. And from the back, he goes, no, he's not coming. I just had to carry on. I take the mic back out. I was like, oh, he's not coming. They were like, who was it? I was like, I can't tell you that now.
Were people excited that you were staying longer, or were they just sort of ambivalent about it?
I think they were sort of like, oh, we were sort like, we enjoyed you, mate, but we were done.
I mean, that happened something similar. I remember I was in Switzerland, right? And it was with Elliot Still, and he opened, he done well, and I went on, I meant to do an hour, and I've died on my arse. It's just horrible.
How many minutes in have you called?
I done maybe 35.
Oh, that's and a valiant death.
And I said, you know what? Let's just wrap this up. You know, they ain't liking it. I come off stage and the promoter's like, you know what? You ran a little bit under time. I'll bring you back on. Right? So he goes on stage. Yeah. He goes on stage and he goes, you know what? Something happened with Jamali's watch, but he's going to do a little bit more time for you guys. And everyone's like, what? And they had to go back on and do another 25 minutes. Of to death.
Why did he want that though?
Fuck no, because he's like, there's an old school thing of time is very important. It's no matter what the show is, as long as you do your time.
Yeah.
Because I think they think you're shortchanging their money if I don't do a time.
Yeah.
Non-comedy people think like that. Yeah. Corporate gigs think like that. Yeah, yeah. Well, we've got this money. It's a lot of money. Why not do 50 minutes to our bunch of cunts at this company? You're like, that's the worst. They don't even want any
time
comedy.
Time doesn't equate quality.
Yeah.
It's, you know, it's what the show is. I mean, you could do it. Like, I think sometimes having this a good 10 minutes is better than having a mediocre hour.
Oh, totally.
You know,
there's,
watching it.
You know, Bobby Mayer. So Bobby, he won't mind me saying this and I'll text him if and double check, but he told me. So he got a bit of telly a few years ago. I love Bobby, right? Yeah.
He's a fucking proper comic.
I did Antique Roadshow with Bobby Mayer. Did you not know about that?
If I'd have been asked to guess what was coming out of Jamali's face.
Did you know about that shit? Bro, that was so fucking funny,
Was it like celebrity or was this just...
No. They were just me and Bobby Mayer.
You were just applying.
No. I got booked for it. They asked me, do I want to do it? And my agent was like, you know, this came up, but, you know. And he was telling me more. It's like, isn't this funny? And I was like... Okay, and they said I can pick who I want to be with, and I said, "Well, I have to do it with Bobby Mayer, innit?"
Oh yeah, because watch the world burn.
Yeah. I thought I have to, but and they were
Jamali,
like,
"Jamali, do you think your future audience buying, like, ticket buying audience are from Antiques Roadshow?" I love agents like Jamali. This is perfect for you. Yeah. What is it? Songs of Praise.
Yeah. No, he wasn't even like. He was like, "Look, I know you don't want to do this, but it's just," he was telling me more like, "Isn't this funny that they asked you to do it?"
Yeah,
type thing. Because he goes, I know you won't do it, and I was like, I'll only do it if I can do it with Bobby Mayer.
Oh, amazing!
And they said, yeah. And Bobby Mayer nearly made my expert cry.
So hang on,
but not like
Antiques Roadshow or Bargain Hunt, because Antiques Roadshow is stuff you've found in your house.
No. Oh yeah, so it's not Antiques. Is it? It's not Bargain Hunt.
Is Bargain Hunt the one where you did you have to go around and find stuff and
then
sell it on?
But not from a car boot sale. We had to do it from antique shops.
Oh.
Oh,
you know what I'm talking about.
Under the Hammer. No, what's it called? Oh, there's going to be people going.
Something Roadshow, isn't it?
It was Celebrity Antiques Road. Trip. Celebrity Antiques Road Trip.
Celebrity Antiques Road Trip.
Oh, there we go.
And I did it. And so it's basically like the same. They're all the same premise, isn't it?
Yeah.
But Antiques Roadshow is the most stuffy.
Yeah.
Honestly, when you said Antiques Roadshow, I was like, what? It's like, do. I've got a vase. I think it might be worth £150. Like, oh, I'll just, in my head, I was like, how are you turning up? Right, bruv.
Yeah. I came with a knife and a bong.
Yeah. I've got this North Face jacket. I can't be asked putting it on eBay.
I got these Supreme crepes. What do you say? I got these Supreme crepes. No, but yeah, so we did it and Bobby was so funny. And Bobby kept on calling my expert Radio 4. I kept on taking the piss out of Radio 4. And it was, and what can she say to him? He's just mad, isn't it? And my expert kept getting mad at me because she would say, oh, for the TV show, don't you want to buy this lovely Rhodesian vase? And I was like, yeah, I just want to buy this knife. And I was like, I want to buy this. And I bought a RoboCop toy that actually made money, surprisingly.
Fuck you.
And everyone was like, this is not going to make money. And I was like, yeah, I will spend £50 and it weighed like 100. And then the other thing I bought, she had this lovely chair and she was like, oh, don't you want this lovely chair? And I was like, nah, I want that. And it was a coat hanger that was made from rowing oars. And it was fucking horrific. And she was like, you want to buy? And I said, yep.
What did you buy that for?
Oh, I must have spent like 150 quid on
that. How much did it sell for?
I think it sold for like 125.
Oh, that's not bad.
But like, I didn't do too bad because the things I bought were so out there that really wanted it or they hated it. Do you know what I'm saying? It was like a really weird.
The profit you made, was that going to charity?
I think so.
But you just didn't give
them. No, I didn't give them.
But what are they getting comedians on? Fucking antiques. Like, what are they doing? I think you should buy this. I think you should know more about comedians, dickhead. Yeah.
And it's just like, it was just a real weird booking choice. And even like the people who were doing the show, like the producers, they were just like, you could tell they were kind of just like, why is he here? Like, you could tell they were just like,
okay. I do feel like you are as far away as possible as who the target of the Antiques Roadshow is. But maybe that's what it is. Maybe they were like, we've got all the old Brexit voting white women.
Yeah, so they want
to. Now we need some young black men to watch it.
Yeah, it's where diversity really bites in the ass.
Yeah, I'm bringing them over. No, I think what happened was is that they were like, you know, someone said in a meeting, we need to make it young. We need to, who's the young guy? Jamali, he wears baseball caps. That's him. And then, you know, I don't know what it was. I think it was just someone in the meeting went, we just need a thing. And it went too far. And then they probably asked me to be like, oh, we don't really want to do this, but let's just ask him. He will say no. And they didn't go like, I didn't go, all right, Bobby Mayer.
Imagine if it fucked up all your tour shows for like a good year. Every time you were like, what's happening? Like Manchester, like, oh, hello.
We saw you
on Antiques Roadshow. Yeah,
funny, well, that man. Happened a little bit to Paul Sinner, didn't it? Because Paul Sinner's quite sort of...
Oh, bro, I've seen...
But he's quite rough on stage and he's, you know, he's...
There's a lot of gay jokes.
A lot of gay jokes. A
lot of dick jokes.
A lot of Asian jokes about his parents and stuff. And then there's these old women who just... I seen him on the quiz show on ITV1 at 5 o'clock and I love him. And then he's like, yeah, I love fucking men! And just see these old women.
I saw him in... I was with him in Middlesbrough doing Peter Vincent's gig. You know that massive?
Yeah.
And when I say, like, they didn't even buy tickets. You know, like those people that are like celebrity hunters and they wait by the back door? Yeah. There was about six old women with photos of Paul Sinner that he didn't even know he took.
Oh,
waiting
okay.
there. And like, and they were like, one woman, oh my God, oh, like going blushing red because she saw Paul Sinner like really it's like. Really
but they don't laugh. They don't laugh. They got, so I've done a gig with Paul. It was when he just got on the chase within a year or two of him being, he's been on it for five, 10 years. Yeah, it's been a while.
Yeah.
Front row, because they're there first, because they're diehards, but they're not diehard of his comedy. They're diehard, he's a one of the chase guys, and they don't get any of it. They don't even get Paul's bit. They fucking didn't get my bit. They're just like sat there going, you're not Paul, you're not Paul, you're not Paul. And then he gets on and does a
Bradley
few blowjob
jokes.
Looks
really different in real life.
If I get any bigger, I'm the beast, mate.
Very convincing wiggy wears on
TV. They're just the worst people in an audience.
Because I think, you know, you can get to a point, I'm not saying Paul, but you know, you can get to a point where people don't even realize you do stand up anymore. Like they just think that you're going to do a live thing of what you're known for. Do you know what I'm saying though? Like they probably don't think he's probably even doing stand-up. They think he's going to do a live chase.
Did you get anything like that when you were doing, did you get that sort of vibe? Because you, one of your catalysts was your Vice documentary, wasn't it?
Yeah. I did stand-up in the doc.
But did
I kind of go away with it. But they thought I was way more woke than I was.
Yeah.
I got that a bit.
Yeah.
You know, people thought I was going to just talk about isn't racism bad for an hour.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, that's not my act.
No.
Sorry. If anything. But that sounded like you were just going, but racism's all right, isn't it?
I mean, yeah. It has its good points. No. well, fuck, I made a career of it for 2 years. But
got Antiques Roadshow.
Yeah, but you know what I mean?
You know?
But yeah, no, I had a lot of people thinking I was going to be mad woke. I think because people also came from clips and not seen the show.
Yeah.
Within the show, the stand up, I wanted to make the stand up out there to show that comedy can still be out there and not be, you know, putting the catalyst of racist and just because you're saying bad things, it doesn't make you a bad person.
Oh my God. That's literally our whole MO on this. that's an important point. That
not to make it like, you know, too altruistic, but I think we've sort of taken away saying bad things from good people and given it just to bad people.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, we sort of, there is, you know, shock and being being extreme with your words has some artistic value.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying though? And I think we sort of gave that away and we sort of make out that, you know, if you say something, you know, bad and it's not funny and it's not
yeah, well, we talk about this quite a lot. Like because I've been called a right-wing comedian before because on stage I'll say something that I don't really believe in just because it's funny.
Yeah.
And then I'm like,
that's a valid comedy position to have, is to say something that you know I don't believe in.
Yeah.
But it's funny to say.
Yeah.
That's valid.
You know? Yeah. It's getting to the point where you can't, we talk and joke about race. And I've had a couple of people message me going, I don't think they're your jokes to make. I don't think you should be talking about it because you're two white guys. You're like, I don't think.
Well, I mean, you are cutting into my work.
Yeah. I want that fucking roadshow money, mate.
Yeah, you want that roadshow money.
Turn it with a baseball guy. What? Snares in it, bruv.
Have a word on the Antiques Roadshow tour, though.
Oh,
that'd
my
fucking
God.
Insane.
Yeah, that'd be the end of one of the shows. but to the snapback is now from older comics or anyone with a brain going, we can make these jokes. You can be controversial. You can take the piss. We know you're on the knife edge of what's politically correct and what's just plain wrong, but that's a comedian's job. And now it looks almost like alt-right, even to defend your position of, I'm a comedian. I'm allowed to take the piss out of certain things.
I used to get upset about it. And I used to be like, well, I'm a comedian. I want to say what I want to say. But something happened. It doesn't matter what happened, but something happened where someone complained about something I said on a big forum. And I got sort of pissed off about it. But then I realized that that's their job. Like, some people's job is to be upset and to be offended. Like, that's their job. My job is to tell pussy jokes and be ignorant. That's my job. That's my job. My job is to be ignorant in the hope that it's truthful.
Jamali, welcome.
But you know what
welcome
I'm saying?
Welcome
home.
That's my job.
Let's talk about disabilities. But not like
yes!
that. But do you know what I'm saying, though? Right? But that's like, their job is to be like, well, I don't. That's their job. Let them do their job. Because I'm not going to stop doing my job.
Exactly. Isn't that the beauty of the internet, though? The beauty of the internet is they have to come and find you to bitch and moan. Yeah. Like on the BBC, on any terrestrial TV, you're like, well, I just turned my television on and you're in my living room. And they almost have this right. Up until now, they had this right to go, I want to shut this down. This isn't allowed.
Government funded TV.
Now you have to come and find us to dip. That's like bitch and moan. Mm. Just fuck off. Yeah, go to one of the other million places on the internet where someone says the boring shit that you like.
We've had this conversation. Like, if someone complains about something in the middle of this podcast, it'd be slightly different if we put a clip out, because we put quite a lot of clips out of this, and like there was something in it where someone was like, I didn't like that, then I'd go, oh, sorry about that. Yeah, soz.
Not for everyone.
But if anyone watched a full episode of this and picked something from the middle and was like, I didn't like this, I can't tell you the speed and anger with which I would tell them to go fuck themselves. Yeah.
It's like the difference between playing a circuit gig on a weekend where you get a party, people going, I didn't like that. And you're like, meh, you haven't booked to see me. But when it's like when you're doing a one-man show, like you guys do more than me, but is there a different tone in the audience? Yeah, yeah, like they're like, we know you. Oh,
they know what they come for at that point. Especially now, I think I'd done my third one. And so the people that came back kind of knew what they were coming for. But I think that's the good thing about touring, is you can just do what you want because people have paid to see you specifically. So even if they don't go there at first, they will eventually. And you have an hour where clubs is just kind of, he's got to go and bang it out.
Yeah.
And
you know, the further line of that is why I brought Bobby May up in the first place. Is
We've done a rattle around the fucking houses.
The sound, it happens and it was fucking great. When you get a bit of the TV, you get more corporate inquiries. So Bobby was getting corporate gigs, but Bobby's not a corporate comic, but he's also living in Brixton and you need to be earning a lot of money. So he was taking them and he said it would never go well. And he would go on stage and he'd be like 12 minutes into a 40 and like people would be hating it or booing. And he would literally do the little lost girl voice and be like, guys, I'm really sorry, but I've got to do me 40 or I won't get paid. And he said every single time he did it, the woman organising it would always just come to the side and be like, come on, love, we'll just pay you. And it worked every fucking time.
What voice?
Funny. Like the little lost girl voice. I'm really sorry, I've lost my mum.
I think you imagine Bobby Bear with a big doe eye.
Matt, at this point, pause this pod. Go on YouTube some of Bobby Mayer's stand-ups, just so you get how fucking ridiculous it is
to put him in a room of fucking accountants.
Yeah,
Christmas.
It's our Christmas, dude. Come and play it, Bobby.
Bobby Mayer has an ability to remain him at all times. You know what I'm saying, though? Like, he don't change. Do you know what I'm saying? So his act is his act, and he's not gonna go up there and go, "Oh fuck, this bit ain't working. Let me." Nah, you're getting this act that he fucking does. I saw him do this one bit where it was about, why do we tell blind people they're blind? And it was like a 10-minute bit. And people, and it's a funny bit, but people were just like, and it was just like, he goes, my eyes, you mean my eye wet, my finger wetness? And it was just, people were fucking furious and I couldn't stop. And he just didn't stop. And he's like, this is the bit, we're doing it. And
if you ever want to know what the Edinburgh Festival is like, it's for people finding those guys, isn't it? You know, not those ones are like, oh, you can play any room. You want to go and watch those. Like, comics want to go and watch guys like Bobby Mayer.
Comic, Bobby, 100%. I got nothing for. But I understand that. I've only done two corporates and they're both fucking, I wasn't meant to be there. I did one for, this is early in my career and it's, you know, it's sellout shit. But I did one for the, you know, those money lenders.
Oh.
I did one for the moneylenders.
Payday loans.
Yeah, the awards.
Who's the biggest cunt? This is the big one.
Yeah, because I did my stand-up bit and they hated me. There was like two tables that liked me of young people and the rest of them hated me. There was this one guy who was just absolutely sweating and with his shirt undone. And every time he spoke, he came and got his award. I was like, well, this speech was sponsored by cocaine. And he just started grabbing the mic. No, we ain't thanking no one. And it was just, and I said to the promoter, I said, listen, when this hits 10 o'clock, I'm gone.
Yeah.
And he goes, it might run over 5 minutes. Like, well, you better wrap up the show because I'm doing 10 and I'm going. Like, it was fucking bad, man.
I did five.
That sounds brutal. It sounds awful.
Do you remember a few years ago when Steve Harris, who's a Northwest comic, a stalwart of our Northwest circuit? Do you know Steve? You work with Steve. So he set up a little business getting private gigs. Did you do any of them?
I know exactly what you mean. And it became famous with comics because it was cash pickup.
Yeah.
Corporate, cash pickup. There's two things you should never hear in the same sentence. Corporate, cash on the night.
How's he got £3,000? No, it's not £3,000. It's 220 quid. So he'd set this business up and it's not there anymore. And he...
It didn't survive.
He'd made this website, right? But he'd built a website in a way where...
Was on like Wix?
No, it was what's called like a spider web website. So what you do is you give it like a million pages. Yeah. So if people searched comedy, I want comedy, because it had so many pages, it would link to that site. But it's illegal to do it that way. It's tricking the Google algorithm. Yeah, so I think he got kicked off Google, right?
And then you're done.
And that killed the business.
But How'd you get kicked off Google?
Because Google go, well, they don't kick you off, but they go, we're going to put you on the 25th
page. Website you probably get on Google, but they kick him off. Fuck me.
Yeah, but they don't build a spiderweb website.
Yeah, right? Yeah, that's true. They stick to the rules somehow.
They do it the traditional way. They've got a Squarespace.
I'll touch kids, but I won't fuck with algorithms.
Who says they ain't got morals? God, sorry, carry on.
Oh, my God. So they boost onto like page 25 of Google or whatever. But initially, he was getting all these inquiries, so people were getting in touch going, "Me wakes Christmas do, I want a comedian to do 20 minutes. And he was going, right, I'll get you one for 400 quid, I'll get you one for 300 quid. So he's asked me, it was a Tuesday night in December, and it was 400 quid to do 20 minutes for this works party in Yorkshire.
That doesn't sound too bad so far.
Right? So I was like, 4 ton, cash on the night.
All good.
I'll take that. This is about cash 5 years ago, night. Right? So I get there, and it's a shit show.
Oh, yeah.
They're all hammered already. They haven't started eating yet.
Any mic?
What?
Any mic?
A radio mic. But they went, we just want you to just be in the room while you do it. I was like, where's the stage? They were like,
be in the room as opposed to what? Just, you know, be here, innit?
Like, what, walk around?
Literally, walk around while you're doing your bits.
Like one of the waiters.
Yeah,
it's
literally.
Like one of those, like one of those 1930s, just like, hey, how you doing? Yeah. Hey.
Climbing to the moon. Yeah, try the fish.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like a table magician. They wanted a table comedian. Yeah, walking around going, hey guys, how you doing?
Nont.
Yeah, everyone's a nod.
So I went, good. Right, so when am I on? They went, after the awards. I went, I'm not hosting the awards, am I? They went, no. I was like, I'm not fucking doing that for this money. So I went, what time will I be on? Because I've got another gig back in Liverpool. And they went, what time is your other gig? And it didn't exist. I was like, it's at midnight. It's a nightclub gig. And
they went, famous late night, midnight Tuesday gig.
But I was just looking at this room going, the longer this goes on. So she went, so what time do you need to leave? I was like, 10:30. I've got to be in the car by 10:30. Because my stage time initially booked was like 9:30. I got there at 9:15 and it was like, I'm not going on in 15 minutes. So it gets to 10 o'clock and I was like, I was meant to do 30 minutes. I was like, look, you're going to have to put me on now or I'm going to have to cut my time down. I've got to be in the car by 10:30. She was like, yeah, we'll do it. It's fine. Got to 10:25. And she went, right, we're going to get you on now because you need to go, don't you? She's hammered, the woman on. You need to go. You need to go.
Yeah, I can see
you gotta go.
Face.
So yeah. No. Listen, we've got a comedian.
They didn't even know.
No, shut up. Just shut up. His name's Adam. He's come from Liverpool and he's doing some jokes for us.
It's thanks so about go on, Adam.
And that was it. So I've got the mic. I'm stood next to her. I didn't know this. I'd gone over to her to go, I've got to go in. And she got, you need to go. Everyone, we've got a comedian. His name's Andrew, come from Liverpool. Go on, babe. Right? And I went, thank you. Right? So my mate, I didn't drive at the time. Tony Cooper took me. You know Tony, who I used to work with? Yeah. And he's like, you know when your mate's embarrassed for you?
Oh, yeah. Right?
He's like, oh, what the fuck? So I'm doing me 5 minutes. I got to 5 minutes in, and it hadn't gone as bad as it should have for that room, because there's people walking around, the bar's not even still open, there's people queuing at the bar, like, shouting for Jager bombs. There's about 20% of the room looking at me, but the one's looking, it's all right.
Yeah.
And I just got to 5 minutes, and I went, ladies and gentlemen, that's all I've got time for tonight, enjoy the rest of your night. And I give her the mic, and she went, when are you doing the rest of it? And I went, what do you mean, the rest of it? She went, you, half an hour? We paid for half an hour? And I went, yeah, but I told you I've got to go at 10:30. I was meant to be on at 9:30. She went, so we just don't get the other 20 odd minutes? This is a you're a thief. You're a fucking thief. And I went, I haven't stolen anything. She went, I want my money back because I'd made her give me the money before.
Oh, yeah.
She said, I want my money back. And I went, you're not getting your money back. And she went, he's taking my money. Oh. And I went, guys, I'm not taking any money. I've been paid for this job. And then her boss come over and was like, just fucking let him go. Go on, lads, you get off. And I got off, but she was fuming. They did write a complaint to Steve asking for their money back. And he just told them to fuck off.
That makes Antiques Roadshow look a lot easier, doesn't it?
Yes, Roadshow. Bro, that's hilarious.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Mate.
He's a Canadian.
When she doesn't even say, for some reason, where she didn't say Adam Rowe, if she goes just Adam, it makes you sound like a guy who just walked off the street. Like, there's a real lack of just like, oh, just there's some little kid called Adam.
I don't even think it was disrespect. I don't think she'd ever learned me saying
it. No, just mad. Like,
the other one is where they've got, have you ever done a round table one where they do too much intro and you would give half the fee to prize the microphone out of the speaker? I had one in Shropshire at the Chartered Surveyors or something, round table. It was great money. And he was in a full, like, you know, like a hear ye, hear ye. Mm. It was mental. Red, like a town crier outfit.
Ruffle shirt and shit.
Fuck it, like the mayor's thing. I was like, what is going on? And he started reading out the blurb from my website on my biography that I'd written. And it was one of the cringiest moments. I can just see suits. And like, you can see future hatred coming. And he's literally like out of the 17th century, like, hear ye, with cutting observations. One of the brightest stars on the Northwest comedy circuit. And I was like, huh?
He works well on his own and as part of a team.
He performed the Edinburgh Festival in 2012 and 13. I'd have given anyone, if he'd just gone, go on, babe, I'd have been like, much better. Yeah. Oh, mate.
The shit we do for money, man. Fucking birthday anything. Gigs and shit.
Anything, essentially.
Yeah, have you done birthday gigs?
I done one birthday gig.
All on the way up, innit?
All on the way up. And it was for 150 quid. And it was in this sort of, above a pub. And the guy said to me, you know, we're going to have some curry. And you come on after the curry. But the curry was like, and he was like, but this curry's good curry. It's like this award. He kept on going about this fucking curry. And I was like, so I've got to follow the curry. All right, cool.
I mean, the curry's won awards.
Yeah. Come on, mate. And it was for his son's 21st. And it was sort of his friends. And it was only like, it was his birthday, but there's only one table of his friends. It was on, you know what I'm saying? Like, there's like a lot of older people and only one table of 21-year-olds, which I find weird.
Like a fucking business meeting put around a...
Yeah, because if it's a 21-year-old's birthday party, there should be other 21-year-olds, not just one table's worth. That, I find that weird. I don't know, but...
That's rich people banter, though, isn't it?
They were rich. Oh, he must have been.
He
was a music producer, what I found. But anyway, so I was booked for 20 minutes, and I've gone on stage... And I've just started doing material. It's bombing. So I started doing crowd work. I'm taking the piss out of everyone. It's gone okay. It's not great, but it's survivable. And I've come off stage and the guy's counting my money. He's got a fucking wad like this. He goes, you know, you went a little bit under time, but I'm gonna give you money. But, you know, you just went a little bit under time. I thought you'd do longer and, you know, you enjoyed yourself. And I was like, oh, how long did I do? He goes, 19 minutes 30 of a 20-minute gig. And he was complaining about 30 seconds.
The rule of 10%, that, innit?
You know?
Fucking
hell. You're doing a 20, 18 or 22 is fine.
Yeah.
That's how you get a wad, by being that much of a tight ass cunt, innit?
I remember just standing there. I was like, what? And he goes, you know, I thought you'd want to stay longer and enjoy yourself. And I was like, why do you think I want to stand here with your weird fucking friends and your curry?
You cunt. And give me the money. Out. Give me the money.
Yeah, and hang out. He thought I wanted to hang out with him and, you know, hey, let me, you know, stay around for a little.
You ever been tipped by one of those douchebags?
Never.
I've had it at gigs, private parties. The guy that's not even paying you comes over, go work that kid.
Yeah.
And then you're like, oh my God, I've got 20 quid in my hand. I've just been douchebag tipped like I'm gigging for Goodfellas. Like, hey, you're all right. It's 20 quid.
At a Jongleurs in Huddersfield. And it was £5 coins. I'm not even messing. It was a Jongleurs on the road. I did it with Doug Segal, Silky and Jim Smallman. And me and Jim Smallman stood on the side of the stage. Someone come over and put £5 coins in my hand.
I heard you get tips in Dubai. That's where people would tip you. That's what I heard. People come up and give you like, you know, if you say, apparently if you sell merch, someone will say, oh, here's, you know, give you like 100 quid for your fucking DVD or whatever.
They are a bit, yeah. I've done gigs in Bahrain where, you know, sometimes a promoter goes, oh, we're going to film tonight. And usually now you're like, oh yeah, yeah, fine. Maybe use it as a clip. And they were like, we're going to film tonight. We might use it as an advert, but obviously we'll pay you an extra 200 quid. Mm. You're like, okay. FYI, that doesn't happen in fucking Huddersfield.
Facts. On the time thing, there's a legendary story. Now, I've heard this about three different comics, right? I don't know which one it is. I'm not going to name any of them because I don't know who it is. But it's about Alex. Do you know the story I'm about to tell about Alexander's in Chester? So Danny McLaughlin now books Alexander's. Have you played it?
No.
Cracking.
So I know about it. It
Cracking
used to be,
gig.
What's his name ran it? But it's Danny's gig.
Yeah. So it used to, back in the day, it was ran by the people who owned Alexander's, and her name was Pauline. And she had a reputation amongst comedians for being a bit of a twat, right? She's out the game now. She can't affect my career. So they used to run it. There was no compare. The opener did 20, the middle did 30, and the closer did 40.
Fucking
right.
Hell, man.
And what would happen is the headliner went on before the opener to go, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Alexander's. I'm your headliner. I'll be back on later. Your opening act is Dan Nightingale, right? Then the opener had to stay till after the interval and bring the middle act on. And the middle act had to stay till after the second interval to bring the headliner on. And that's how they did it.
The headliner didn't have to do that. The headliner was asked, and if you did it, you got an extra 20 quid.
Oh, right. I didn't know that.
Yeah. That was the deal. They knew you didn't want to do it as the headliner. So they said, obviously, if you do that, we'll give you an extra 20 quid.
Or they just give that, say, double that 20 quid and just let an open mic at MC the night. It'll be a lot better.
Why would you do that when you've made up your own batshit crazy system?
That is mad.
So the story I was told was a Northwest headline comic was closing Alexander's. This is early noughties, I think maybe late 90s. And he gets there and he goes on and introduces the opening act. And then the opening act was like, I've got to go and get me train. Like, whatever. So the headliner, dead sound, went, I'll bring the middle on. Fine. So the headliner goes on in the middle and goes, ladies and gentlemen, next act is Jamali Maddix. Here's your middle act. Then goes on at the end, told the middle to get off and just went on and did 37 minutes. And the woman who booked the gig was like, did fucking 37. It's 40 for a reason. So he literally, the audience was still there, and he told them all to sit back down, went back on, stood in silence for 3 minutes exactly, and then left, got his money, told us to fuck off, and said, I'll never play your club again.
That is G, man.
That, honestly, I've never heard that, but I love those legendary stories that have like...
go round and round.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the story I hear.
That's great.
Oh my God.
I mean, that guy's got fucking balls, man.
To stand in silence, like...
I respect that.
2 minutes 58.
Because I feel like that's a situation that if I was in, I would be in the shower and be like, I should have done that. You know what I'm saying? Because it's one of those things of at the moment, you
just
don't
scrubbing
think
the regret off.
Yeah, you don't think to do that.
Oh, on the drive home, you're like, oh God, I should have said all of these things.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry about
it's
that.
It's even that you don't even say it. It's just that, because sometimes the situation is so shocking, you don't know what. It's not that you don't have the ability not to say anything, but you just don't know what to say.
The level of country takes you by surprise.
Yeah. You kind of go, oh, because you just don't expect such a... Like a situation happened the other day where I did a gig and someone was kicking off. So I got them kicked out. And as a joke, I said from stage, I said, how much did you pay to get in? I'll pay you to leave. Right. And then the promoter then gave the money to the people out of my money. And I was like, no. And I was like, okay. And I left. And then I was like, wait, And I rang him and I was like, I want my 20 quid back, actually. And he goes, yeah, all right.
As he's there cleaning the toilets.
Yeah. But then, did you know, because I just didn't, because it's such a weird scenario, you kind of go like, and it really was bothering me all weekend. I was like, why did you give him my fucking money? Like, I just didn't.
Boot them out.
And then I was like, so I rang him and I was like, you know what, man? Like, I'm not happy with that situation. Like, I had it all built up. And he was like, yeah, I'll just give you about 20 quid, mate. I was like, ah, fair enough. And that was it.
I did that at my tour show in Blackpool. When that guy was a cunt to you and then was even cunty with me.
Oh, he really lost his temper.
Yeah.
Blackpool Comedy Club.
But it was my tour show. So what had happened was, did we talk about this on a Patreon or a public?
I honestly can't remember. About a month and a half ago, wasn't it?
So, sorry for the repeat for anyone, but I had a tour show that was rescheduled from March until September at the Blackpool Comedy Club. And it sold quite well. It was fun. But because I hadn't done an hour for like 8-9 months, I was like, what I'll do is I'll compare it. I'll bring two support acts and I'll do like 40-50 at the end.
Good minute. Good
so night. they get a full night, even though I'm not gig fit for
doing
an hour.
2 hours, yeah.
In the end, I ended up doing over an hour at the end, didn't I? Like an hour and five or something.
55, I think it was. But you did stuff in the previous
but
night.
But I'd compared 20 minutes at the top before Dan.
And they were sound. They were fun. Everyone was enjoying it.
It was a great gig. Dan goes on. And you know the typical comic thing? You're ripping it, but you can see the one guy who's having a shit time. So he'd done a bit about, was it seagulls?
He had been laughing.
Yeah.
But he just got a face on about one thing. I'd said something in passing to him.
Offhand, yeah.
He was talking to his missus going, bah, 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 bah. And I was like, basically went, fuck, you're loud, you can't whisper. It was real, he was like.
Just wait, just to keep him quiet, yeah.
Yeah, so.
He had that real Blackpool face.
You don't say that to fucking me.
And you went, mate, if the seagull bit's not going to get you, I don't know what is. So then he went to Dan, I come to see Adam, I didn't come to see you lot. This is doing me fucking head in. So I was like, right. So when I went back on to bring Dan off, I went, mate, come on, what's the matter? You're going to still see well over an hour of me. You're getting more than you've paid for, really. He went, no, that's not what I paid for. And I went, well, no one says that at my shows. So because he was saying he was getting off, I went, you can have your money back. I don't know whether Ryan gave me, because I don't really look at my breakdowns, to be honest with you. My agent could just take all of my money and be like, it's just 25
30
quid.
30 quid from that.
But I told him, I was like, if you want to leave, you can fucking have your money back. I'm not going to like, I'd rather give someone their 12, 14 quid back, whatever my ticket price was, to not have them be able to say, I went to see Adam Rowan, I didn't get what I paid for. You fucking pieb.
My favourite bit of that was, as he was going, well, I didn't pay for you, I could pay to see Adam Rowan. This woman at the other side went, well, we're enjoying it, so shut the fuck up. And the whole room, it was the most northern moment.
Yeah.
And I literally got the table down and hid behind it like, it's kicking off, yeah. Let's get an extra northern.
I do like when that person does take your side. Because sometimes I'll go off on someone. Because I like to be mean. And I'll go off. And sometimes I go, am I in the wrong? And then someone just goes, no, she's been a cunt all night. Yeah. And you go, yeah. She fucking has, isn't it?
Yeah. Should we have an advert?
Yeah, man. Good chat.
What's happening, guys? Today's episode is brought to you by Supreme CBD. Now, CBD oil has got so many uses. It's good for your mental health. It can help you sleep. It's really good for your skin. There's so many uses for this, and a lot of people are starting to use this and feel a lot better about their lives. We've got a 30% off code for our listeners. The promo code is WORD, WORD. You can go to supremecbd.uk. You can get some oil. They come in gummy bear form. There's loads. It's dead good. We love this company. They're here on board with us. Go and support them, and let's get back to the podcast.
Oh, by the way, I'd love to do live at Compton. I don't know how it'd go. I don't think it'd be the perfect place to do an Edinburgh preview, but I'd give it a crack.
I think they got a like someone was telling me about a comedy gig they have in Compton or one of the Inglewood or something. And it's like a clown. I've seen the videos online. And it looks like if you're going to bomb, it's going to be the worst bomb ever. But if you do well, it looks like it would be.
I gig in Runcorn. I'll be all right. But also, I know
the brothers and sisters.
Yeah. I don't think Compton's going to be as bad now as it was. Like,
apparently,
you know,
it's gentrified now.
Yeah. It's like mid. Because you hear Compton and you hear Boys in the Hood and like.
Same as Brixton.
What's the other one?
NWA.
What's the other film? Boys in the Hood.
Where about do you live? We're back on, by the way. You just have to figure out where we started.
East London.
Fine. It's your job, isn't it? East London. Where, like, Hackney Base? Is that East London?
Near there, yeah. Sweet. Yeah.
I think if I did do the London for a year thing.
You're London not doing it. Don't do it. Don't give me a fucking panic attack on it. Well, I'm not coming to Turnpike Green just so you can record a fucking podcast.
You never leave in Liverpool.
Don't think so.
Yeah. You love Liverpool. Like,
I could see myself just to give him an actual stroke. I could see myself doing like New York for a year.
Yeah. That makes sense.
On Zoom.
Yeah. But I feel like. I could see my wife's face when I'm like, I'm going to New York with Adam. I'm not going to get off the word, but we're going to rent studio space in New Jersey.
I can imagine you, yeah, because you, I've never seen someone rep a city as hard as you do. Like, you really go in for your city. Like, I would think you was in a gang. See, how hard you go for Liverpool.
I think your mistaken tweets about Liverpool as being the city and not the football club.
No, it's just you have a love for that city that I've never seen. Like, yeah. I'm from London, I love London, but even I go, I'm a bit, you know, but you are through and through.
Do you know what's really
Liverpool,
funny
man?
Though? There's I'm not that bad, am I? Like, there's so many more professional scousers compared to me.
Okay.
We talk about this quite
a
lot.
It's a scouse thing, though, isn't it? Like,
yeah.
It's pride.
It's not patriotism.
Yeah, there is
pride.
There is a mad sort of pride,
parochial
like,
nature.
Because even the black cabs still have the stickers of, like, we ain't buying the sun. And it's like, you got no one selling it. But it's still that fucking really, you know, real.
Yeah, that's it.
It's next. Yeah, if you look next to you on the left, there's a sticker.
See, on the light
box.
You
know what I'm saying, though, it's sort of that real. Like, in London, we just kind of. We sort of shift and change. It's not a good thing, but you sort of shift and change a lot, and they're sort of, you know.
Is it because London is so many things?
Yeah.
Like, it's every conceivable, like, creed, colour, social spectrum. Yeah, there's the ultra-wealthy of the world, along with some of the poorest people in Europe.
It feels like it's changing now, where it feels like that sort of, you know, that the people who are the working class are getting driven out hard. You know what I'm saying? Where before
it all ended up in like Kent and Essex.
They're really pushing them out. You know, like you can see it now where you go Hackney and you don't see that many working class people. You see a lot of yuppies and shit. Like,
well, Brixton got mentioned. I mean, Brixton 25 years ago was rough, man. Now Brixton's like it's properly
on
the way.
You can't afford a parking space in Brixton.
Right,
like, that's how fucking bad it is there.
Do you know I once rang? Do you know when I was like 17 and I was looking at me moving out because my dad was doing me as in and fucking moving out. I was on Zoopla, right?
I'd say I'm going to Brixton. No. Mayfair. I'll try Mayfair. I like the fags. Kensington. There's one of them in Liverpool. That'll be cheap.
See that Buckingham Palace
is so
lad.
Much
that is
than
so
what
funny.
You think it is. I seen an advert for a city centre spot, right? And it was something like £125 a month. And I was like, I can afford that. So I rang them and I was like, I want this. £125 a month. I work at Mackey's.
You recorded Mackey's for professionalism.
I'm earning like a few hundred quid a week. I can, £125 a month. I want this fucking, I thought it was a one bedroom apartment. It was a parking space in Liverpool one.
You can live in a parking space.
I thought you meant you were doing your dad was doing your editing and you were going to London.
No,
what a fucking
what
a 17-year-old move that. Dad, you're pissing me right off. That's it. I'm going Amsterdam. Fuck you. Oh my god.
That's funny.
Yeah, the woman.
I honestly thought you were on Zoopla in London.
I can remember the woman's tone of voice on the phone. She was like, "What do you mean you want this place?" She was like, "Where do you live?" And I was like, in West Derby at the minute, but like always wants to live in town. She's like, "You do know this is a parking space." And I was like, I remember going, for the 125.
It's one of them phone calls where she's like, this has not been worth my time in terms of the waste of time, but it's worth it for the fucking anecdote. She dined out on that for 3 years. Carol, tell the story about that guy that rang up about the parking space. Anyway. Yeah. He said it's from West Derby.
I'm earning a couple hundred quid a month. I could make this work.
How's London town been with the old fucking Rona and the lockdown? Has it felt more mental? Does it still feel quiet? What's going on?
You realise that paying a lot of money for a flat when you can't leave it ain't worth it. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, you realise that you are buying it for the city and not the home. Because your home is shit. You know what I'm saying?
You're paying the extra money for all the shit you can go out
and
do.
Yeah, but then when that's not there, you realise, oh, this is my house and there's not much here.
In the lockdown, I was taking pictures. My daughter would be in the garden and I'd be like, oh, I'll send it to a couple of mates that lived in London.
Yeah.
And I stopped myself and just didn't send them the picture because it had my garden in the background. And I was like, I feel like I'm going to be gaslighting my friends via WhatsApp because they're in a two-bedroom flat in fucking
friends, man, cause it's
Hammersmith.
It's horrible. I mean, and you realise that, like, as well, that you don't need to be in London. Like, the idea of being in London for showbiz just doesn't exist anymore. Like, there's nothing I didn't do on Zoom that I couldn't do from anywhere in the world. Do you know what I'm saying? That whole idea of, like, if you don't live in London, I just don't think that's true anymore.
Changing,
I think it kind of, like, I think I dispelled that myth.
I think this podcast has become an advert to get Jamali back to the north.
Do you know, I think the getting no work left a bad taste in my mouth. Like, Frog and Bucket was not having it, man.
What the fuck happened there? Like, there's loads of Jamalis knocking about, like, the Northwest comedy scene. We've got too many of you, Jamal. Just too many of
because,
you.
Because that's what, remember I did the Frog and Bucket, you probably don't remember, you've done so many.
But I
the,
do.
The Gong Show, and I won.
I do remember
and
you
they
doing
never,
it.
And they never gave me spots.
Yeah.
They wouldn't give me spots, and I don't know, maybe I did bad there. Maybe my
yeah, I know. Fuck, it's a really serious point about maybe even like racism within Northern booking, and Adam's just put a I found a hole.
Not no serious point, but yeah, man, I'm gonna tell you, but just a bunch of clubs just weren't having it. You know, it is what it is.
Yeah, it's a shame, innit? And it's probably endemic of a bigger sort of like we just book what we like and what we know, and it's a failing, really, isn't it?
Yeah, it's all right.
The next time I saw you. Was at the festival also, in the Alps. Remember?
Yeah, Altitude. Yeah.
Like, I think I literally saw you at Beat the Frog and was like, this guy's quite good. And then 6 months later, he's one of the featured acts at Altitude. And I was like, yeah, turns out you don't need that work in Manchester. Because you're one of the featured. I was like, I basically got it as like, we need a compare for a couple of those early shows. There's a tier system at Altitude. If you've never heard of Altitude, it's a ski gig. It's the weirdest thing.
It's one of my biggest fucking bugbears with this fucking COVID thing. Okay, there's death. Okay, the economy's crashing. But I was booked to do Altitude for the first time this year, and it obviously got fucking panned.
And
I was so excited.
It sounds mental, but small comedy festival takes over part of, what's it called? Meinhofen. It's a really nice like ski resort, and you're just bumping into... one of the weirdest things that's ever happened to me in comedy was my flight was getting in at the same time as Sean Locke and Bill Bailey. And the guy who rang the festival was like, so Dan, if it's all right, you're getting in first. Do you mind waiting around 40 minutes because Sean Locke and then Bill Bailey will come and you'll get transported together? And I had to be like, yeah, cool. Yeah. Like I'm going to go, no, fuck him. I'll get the flight.
Let them get their own car, bitch. Yeah.
So I was having a beer at Munich Airport, this beautiful like German lager going, this is weird. Look, you get loads of these moments in stand-up, don't you? Where you're like, this is weird. This is my job. This is my life. Sean Locke taps me on the shoulder like, you Dan? And then... proceeds to join me for a beer. Sean Locke, by the way, is as sound as you think he is. He's a fucking good guy. Then Bill Bailey and his like techies come because he goes everywhere with people that set up his instruments. They turn up and we have one of the most batshit semi-pissed drives from Munich to Austria. Bill Bailey has got a bottle of the strongest peach schnapps you've ever fucking seen from Munich Airport. Me, Sean Locke, two techies and Bill Bailey get fucked up on peach schnapps on the weird autobahn into the Austrian hills. And I was fucking steaming by the time we got there. At one point, Bill Bailey at a service station got out and we're all like going for a half-cut piss. He comes back with, and this is the bonus of being a wealthy person. You know when you're at a service station with your mates and you're like, I'll just buy this to be funny. But obviously you're not a millionaire, so you've got a limit on what you can spend. He spent at least 350 euros on tat. He came back with fucking toys. We were hammered drinking, like such a surreal moment where I'm talking to Sean Locke, pissed on schnapps about Chelsea, and then like a toy dinosaur comes into my view because Bill Bailey's like, amazing. And we got there, they were so sound, and that was the first time I'd seen you since Beat the Frog, and we were in fucking Austria in the hills. Yeah. You absolutely smashed it, it was great.
Yeah, it was a good festival that time. Yeah, it's weird as well. Is like it's funny you say that because I realized this the other day that I was thinking about the place I've been. I've been more countries with comedians I hardly see than my own girlfriend.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying though. Like we've been to Austria.
yeah.
Like, we've been to somewhere really like you know what I'm saying. Like we traveled like
you and me have been to Beat the Frog in Manchester, Austria, and Runcorn.
Yeah, man, we've literally seen the world together.
It is weird, isn't it? You I end love up those like moments. Sort of. Like, because you can go on one of those abroad trips with a comic who you're not really mates with. Mm. And by the end of it, it's like you're like brothers in arms from war. If you do an Edinburgh Festival package show with two other comics who you don't know, by the end of it, they're your fucking best mates on the planet.
Hashtag never forget. You'll always remember the guys you do those package shows in Edinburgh.
Did you do a package show, Dan?
I did Big Value in 2004.
Oh, damn.
Yeah.
Who was on with you?
There was two shows. The early shows was Hills Barker, Kev Dewsbury, Josie Long, and Seymour Mace.
Yeah.
And the late show was me, Mark Oliver, uh-huh. Will Hodgson, and Mick Ferry.
It's a bill, that.
Oh, wow.
The year before had been, I don't know if it was the year before, had been like Jim Jefferies, Steve Hughes, and the year after, I think, was Manford.
Yeah.
Like,
it's weird when you look at
it's so weird how it works, but.
Yeah, I never did big, I did the reserve.
Pleasance Reserve.
Bombed.
That's
every
the
night.
Golden ticket, that though.
Who is it? Who is your alumni of that year?
I was on with Tom Little.
I love Tom.
You know Tom Little? He
His
was
videos
there.
Are smashing it at the minute. Just a little side note there. Check, this is Tom Little on Twitter. He's been doing some amazing work during lockdown. He's got really creative with his stuff. Just got, you'll love his videos. Go and check them out.
He's a funny guy.
Yeah.
A poet guy who doesn't do it no more.
No shit.
Yeah, a poet guy who doesn't do it no more. And yeah, I can't remember.
Not a good sign, is it? It's not a good sign.
If no, no, no. One of
if it was Joe Lycett, you'd remember, wouldn't it?
Yeah, I took Jim Carrey. That was fucking that long ago.
Who was your big value? You did big value, didn't you?
Yeah, I did it with. I did it twice.
Did you do it with Dane?
No.
But,
Otway did it with Dane.
Right.
I did it with Elliot Steele, Ed Hedges, and Vince Atta. The first time I did it, and then the second time I did it, they were like, "We've got a gap." Like, I was already doing the festival, and they're like, "We need a compere. Someone's dropped out," and I was like, "I'll do it." It's a way to sell tickets because you're showcasing. Totally. And that one was with Harriet Dyer, who I've become quite close with across that month. Alistair Williams and George Rigdon.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to look online to see who I did it with because I feel bad that I forgot the names.
And they'll remember you. I know that.
No. One of them's still around. I just can't fucking...
But the Pleasance Reserve is a golden ticket because you get paid to do the month, they put you up, and you get guaranteed a spot to do your debut hour at the Pleasance.
It's
like a scholarship.
Mate, the big value when I did it back in, 1812, you got 500 quid accommodation. It was great. And it just gradually over the years, they've depreciated in value. Is it weird that the day we found out we're probably not going to be gigging for about 6 weeks, we've come in here and romanticized about stand-up?
Yeah, I know.
More than we've done on this podcast for ages.
Well, I apologize if I made it too comedy-centric.
Oh, mate, we don't...
That's not you. That's us.
It's us. Like, our listeners are fucking well into it. We sort of... We get so many questions sent in about stand-up that we tend now to only talk about it when they come in. But when it happens naturally with a comic, it's
I miss nerding out about comedy. There is a sort of thing of miss talking to comedians and miss talking shit. And
I'm going to go. I've had this weekend off, but last night I went down to Hot Water to hang out. And I'm going to go back tonight. Brennan Reese is doing the late show at Hot Water tonight. So I'm going to go meet him for food and then go and watch the late show. Dope. I went down last night. Danny McLaughlin compared, and he's, as far as I'm concerned, a top three compere in the country.
He's so fast.
He's so fucking ridiculously quick. His nostalgic references that someone heckled last night and he said, "Shut up, the witches of Eastwick." And it just fucking leveled me. Also, he shit out at one point. If you haven't checked Danny's stuff out, he's got loads of clips on the Hot Water channel. He's also started a podcast recently called The Damn Daniel Podcast. Go and check it out. It's brilliant. But you know when you see a comic go to say something on stage and they sort of reverse out of it. So he was talking to a girl and she was like, "I'm a makeup artist," but he'd already spoken to these five loud Scouse women and he was like, "That's defo one of them." Statistically, five Scouse women have got Mua in the Facebook name. They've got MUA, one of these. And one of them went, "No, we're not Muas." And he went, and he never said it. When he come off, I went, "You nearly called them Hooers, didn't you?" And he went, "Yeah." I was like, "I seen you." Just go, I'm done with that.
I'm not going to go with that part of the face.
He's so good with the wordplay like that. He was in the back of the Nottingham where I was doing a bit of crowd work. And one guy was like, what do you do for a job? And the guy went, "I work with diggers." I got a hot flush. I was like, "Ooh!" I was like, "You really don't want to get any of those letters wrong in that job description.
You don't want to say that too fast."
I know. And Danny was at the back going, "Mate, you've got to go back on and go, digger what? Digger, please." And it's just how his head works. I just saw it firsthand and went, And he's there doing, you need to do a little bit of wordplay with it.
I did a gig with Danny Mac in Manchester and we both came in dressed in the exact same outfit. And then he went, "I knew this would happen." And he bought a different jumper because he knew we were dressed the same. Like he preempted that. We had exactly the same jumper. It was like a Thrasher jumper, like black jeans. I was about to say,
it
was
a he preempted it.
So he compared last night. Nick Page opened, who's sort of got that posh English older guy about him. Simon Wozniak in the middle. And I went down because Danny was on No Wanted to Hang Out with a mate and talk to him, but also because, and Deliso closed, just a great bill. But watching Simon Wozniak again, he's just got it, you know.
I think Wozniak is a future. I saw this a year ago. Like 3 years ago, I gig with you and you're on in the middle. And it was the most difficult night of my fucking year. And I got pissed off with the frog and the guy, like the tech call. I was like, why is he in the middle? I did it in front of it. I was like, get him the fuck out of the middle. He's a headliner and you're being a bell end. Stop ruining my night. Give the crowd what they want. And I think Wozniak's getting to that point.
Yeah,
and you were like, thanks for that, mate. But it sounded aggressive because I'm trying to compliment you and also make my fucking life
fucking
easier.
Up my night. Yeah.
Should have headliners headlining. Middle acts should be middle acts. Like, and Wozniak's at that point where you're like, we need to get him on. He'll be great, but Wozniak needs to be headline. He's not far off being like, you can't.
It's funny, man.
He's
very funny.
Because he's got a similar accent to me and a similar style to me, he's one of the acts I most worry about following. I did a weekend there a couple of weeks ago and he was in the middle and I was closing. And I had
not good, ideal.
I had good sets all weekend because it's hot water and it's fine. But Carl was there one night. Do you remember? And we were just watching. And I was like, it's just fuck. I'm crying laughing.
He used to be
and
shit as well.
He was shit. He was really fuck. He got gonged off twice one night. Me and him ran a gong show for a bit at Baby Blue on a Wednesday. And he got gonged off and he went, oh, I didn't get to do my meal deal bit. I went to the audience, should we let him do the meal deal bit? And he went back on and then just didn't do the meal deal bit. So he gonged him off.
You ran a gong show at Baby Blue.
We did.
That is, honestly, sounds like-
He hustled. Adam hustled.
Man, that sounds terrible.
That sounds like the worst sentence in comedy,
yeah,
isn't
I could,
it?
I would.
Gong show at Baby Blue.
I remember I did Baby Blue and hecklers were tagging each other's heckles. Like they were like tagging it. They were like, and then you could say, and I was like, what the fuck?
Steve, have you thought that you could call him a cunt like this? Jamali, 2 seconds, we're going to mug you up.
Yeah. But they were like tagging each other's heckles. And like, I remember like walking off and being like, never again. And then they booked me for a weekend. This is when I needed weekends. And it was looming in my diary for 6 months. You know, you just see it and every week is 1 week closer. Doing a weekend there, and then luckily
five more sleeps till death.
And then luckily it got pulled. But I was
such a shame as well because Baby Blue could have been. Everything about the room screams comedy club.
Yeah, I just like that.
Do you know what I mean?
I also think what we all sort of glossed over there. There's everything about that bit of the docks has a dark, dark history that has soaked into those walls. Like it like the history of that bit of
the slavery dock.
Yeah, mate. You're like, oh god, that you can feel the history in it. You're like, not all good though.
Do we used to have to smoke the room out before the gigs?
What?
We used to have to get flavored smoke. And smoke the room out for
someone
hour.
With a guy in a corner with a shisha pipe or something.
That's what it looked like because the smell was that bad because of the history. We'd have to smoke the room out for an hour before the gig could start.
Just go, hear the ghosts. Fucking hell. Oh my God.
But it looks like it's
like
perfect
a good
shape. It's everything's.
It's got personality.
I remember they had that one female doorman who just used to fuck it.
Anita.
Fucking put people in headlocks. Yeah, she was. She did not fuck around, did she?
She's lovely, Anita.
The blonde one.
Yeah.
Oh, she's great.
I loved Anita. She always made like, she was always just dead sound.
Yeah. And she could twat you.
Oh, yeah.
You love it.
Yeah.
Jamali,
I didn't want to make that a fancy thing because I didn't, but yeah, like that is. Yeah.
Your bill was Malcolm Head, you, Tom Little, and Joe Sutherland.
Joe Sutherland, that's the name.
Joe Sutherland,
I had it on the tip.
Shout out to Joe. Big respect.
Sorry, I forgot him. No. I
speak to you later. I'll give you a call. See you at Christmas.
Yeah. I'm a shit with names.
Who's the guy that you... We're going to talk about some of the stuff. Carl's got some bits, but
sure.
Who's the guy that you see on a bill and you go, like Adam did with Wozniak, and go, fuck.
I have... Do you know, I don't have that, but I do have the bad luck omens. You know those ones? Every time I see him, I bomb.
Oh, that's so funny.
Jeff Innocent? Yeah. Every time I see Jeff, if he's in the room, I die. I don't know what it is about. I'll be killing all week and then Jeff will be, and I'll just die. Like, I think he's my bad luck charm.
He's a good comic. It's not that he's a bad comic.
No, he's a fucking great comic.
It's
not nothing to do with that. He's a great comic, but I'm just saying it's just bad luck for me.
Yeah.
Whenever he's there, it's just my bad luck. I just seem to always die when he's there. And Dane for a long time, I would always die if I was on
Dane Baptiste.
It's just your bad luck, you know, my bad luck of charm. It's just every, for whatever reason, it was like an omen.
Yeah, I know what you mean. To
have you got any of them where you just gig with them and you're like...
I've been some once. Dan Evans from Brighton has literally had him turn up in a dressing room and go, oh, God. Oh, I never have a good one when you're here. You're like, hiya, mate. Nice to see you.
I like both of those dudes, you know what I'm saying? Like, me and Dana called it, but it's just for whatever reason, it was just bad luck. It was just not my night when it happened. I don't know why, man, but it's just that weird.
I don't have that, but I've told you before, I have that with York as a town.
Yeah.
York can just Yorkie eat a bag of fucking dicks, as far as I'm concerned.
You know what my town is? Oswald Twistle.
Oh yeah, the Manford gig.
That fucking place.
How many times have you done Oswald Twistle?
Once, and because it was that bad.
Yeah, but that's not a bogey town. You had a bad gig. No, I've done York 10 times and took a fucking beating 10 times.
Have you been Oswald Twistle?
No.
You haven't been? I see then. That's why you don't
know. Lancaster as well. I'm not good at.
Have you
Lancaster.
Got a problem with historic northern towns that have like named their county?
Yeah.
Right, okay.
I Lancaster, that Sunday gig in Lancaster. I just get fucking slapped every time I do it.
Last time I did it, you were meant to be doing it and you had like a car breakdown. And I was like, brilliant, that's worked out great. And about 8 minutes in, I was like, fuck you, Adam, and fuck your broken car. Because I basically ate my balls instead of you eating your balls.
I did that gig with Jamie Sutherland comparing, Alan Cochran opening, me in the middle, and Gary Delaney closing.
Oh,
and we
Bill.
All died on our asses. Now, I'm sorry, that's not our fault.
It's not all, it can't be all of
you. No, you can't have a bill like that. Like, it's just not possible for that bill to collectively decide to be shit
about,
that night.
There's a thing about that dying in silence. Like, I don't mind going down in flames. Like, I don't mind everyone being like, fuck you. And like, you know,
yeah, the Blues Brothers moment.
Yeah, I'm good with that. Like, I love that, but like, I love it, but I can deal with that. But when it's just that, we don't want to hear it, silence. That's just, that's
disappointment.
Real death.
When
apathy.
You hear someone clear their throat, when you.
I remember I did Leeds and it was so bad that I had to do half an hour and I was doing my closing bit and I looked at my watch and I was 10 minutes in and I was already doing my clothes. Well, I was rushing through bits where it's just all dying. And then I ended up doing crowd surfing. I said, who wants to see me crowd surfing? And I was like, not really. And I didn't. I jumped in the crowd and there was these two girls that were there and they went, ugh! And they both jumped to the side.
Yeah,
and
brilliant.
I just kind of...
like the opening scene of School of Rock. Yeah. Just Jack Black, face planted.
Died and broke your ankle.
No. Yeah, it was fucking horrible.
There's some... The passage of time when you're having a bad gig, it's just like... Yeah.
It's
so
literally
painful.
Like time
it's
slows down.
It's when you get that really bad one, you can feel the tingling in the back of your throat and you're... I remember one, I did this show in Rotterdam. It was my first international show. So I had these two sets in the same venue. The first one went all right. Then after one of them, Tom Rhodes gave me a joint and I was blasted.
Tom Rhodes. There's a legendary name.
And he gave me a blunt and I was blasted. And I went back on stage. I'm doing my act and I'm just dying. And I'm high. So paranoia is kicking in and I'm dying. And I look out in the crowd and it was the same people from the last show and I'm just doing the same jokes. And I didn't realize. And then where I'm high, if I was sober, I would have been like, oh, I've done the same bits and done side. But where I'm high, I'm just like anxiety and I can feel, you know, like that old school fear that's in your stomach.
Yeah.
It tastes like a battery. And I was just like.
And apparently Dutch audiences will just go,
oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, no, we don't think this is funny. So we're just going to shit here.
Silent, They will stare at you.
I've heard they don't laugh.
Yeah, they do now.
Yeah.
They never, when I first started going there, they didn't. But I think now with the internet, they started laughing. But they will just like, it's notorious. Like, you'll do a show and it will go bad. And they will come off stage and they will quote jokes back to you. Yeah. They'll be like, oh, I love that bit you did about.
Yeah.
Because they come from cabaret. So I think they think it's rude to make noise.
Right. Okay.
So they sort of like, you know, they watch cabaret where it's like comedy and music. So their whole thing is like, we'll watch a show.
Yeah. The culture of a crowd is a weird thing.
They love a premise.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Like, if you have a good premise, they clap a premise. They go, oh, that's a oh, we want to hear where this goes. The punchlines, they have no interest in.
See, that's weird, because I got to New Zealand 12 years ago, and I was all like, observation, caricature, and like, they love a punchline. Yeah. I was watching the guys who were like, that's a joke, and they were like, we get it. That they fucking love the jokes. And I quickly realized that I had to really stop fucking around and get to what I was calling the punchline.
Yeah.
It's a weird cultural thing.
Do you think New Zealand is worth that travel? in terms of a city? Like, in terms of a country, is it worth flying all that way when you get there? Do you feel like...
Yeah.
I feel like when I go to New Zealand, for a 24-hour flight, I go...
I know what you mean. Because it's not 24 hours. Door to door, it's 48.
Okay,
because I was like, I lived in Chester at the time. This is 10 years ago. I had to get the train to Manchester, connecting flight to London, London to Sydney. Then you connect from Sydney to...
Oh, it's London to Dubai, then Sydney. Isn't it?
Yeah, of course. Longer, and you stop in Dubai for the weird, like, I'm not slept. And I'm like, I'm eating a cheeseburger at 5 in the morning. And I, when I was 10 years in and did it for the first time, it was one of the best things I'd ever done.
I was talking about the comedy festival.
I loved it. Yeah. But I went again and had another good time. And then I went the year after. So I went in like consecutive years. Yeah. And that third time, because I'd done it the year before, I was like, yeah, I'd rather be in Widnes or Warrington. Because then it becomes a bit of a schlep. Like, it's not something you do every time.
I know this is like old hat as well, but I feel like once you've been in Australia, you get it. The same way when with me in Canada, I've been in America, I get what you're doing.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
I mean, they would vehemently argue that point.
I understand that, but it's like once you've been to France, you get Belgium. You get it. I get what you're doing.
Is that what you're like, in Rotterdam, you were like, well that's me doing Italy. It's good as. No, I know.
But like, you know, but Rotterdam, it's like, I've been Amsterdam. I get what you're doing in Rotterdam. I don't need to see at this point. Do you know what I'm saying? No, and I feel like that. For me, New Zealand
Kiwis
are
particularly sound though. Like it's a, like I got Australians there and I fucking love them. Like they're so sound. Yeah. And I had a great time, but I know what you mean. It's a long old journey. Yeah. To just as well, the first night we went out, do you remember Mickey D? Australian comic? He's like,
you're
at the, you're at fucking Auckland, you're going to have a fucking great time. You're like, yeah, you're dead excited, but you haven't slept properly for 2 days and your body clock's off. And we were out, we're like, let's get fucking shots. And you're like, yay. And I fell asleep, propped up. I wasn't even like sat properly. I was like, and I fell asleep mid-body. He's like, you dickhead. Fucking, there's a bit of jet lag. And then you're out again.
See, one argument I have to that is that you're going to New Zealand with some of the funniest people in the world, right? If you just went on holiday to New Zealand, would you be happy with the
city? That's his question. Oh. You're mistaken. He's saying as a country.
Oh, as a country. I'm not shitting the festival. The festival was great.
New Zealand 2 days.
Oh, you think I'm not shitting on the festival? I love the festival.
My whole experience is the classic comedy club in Auckland.
Yeah.
Wellington, where you stay in that amazing art house hotel.
Yeah.
I can't see New Zealand out of the prism of that festival. Okay. But New Zealand seems sound. It seems sound. But Wales is nice.
Isn't
it beautiful mountains and a very relaxed point? Like,
that's the point of the bit I was making. Is the terms of, I wasn't about the festival. And I love the festival and I love doing comedy there.
Totally.
I wasn't
shitting
on the festival.
Mate.
Please book me back. But I was saying,
I live in Chester. I'm an hour and a half from some of the nicest mountains in Snowdonia. Yeah.
It's just that, I don't know. I feel like some places I go there and I go, oh, it's far, and I get it. You know what I'm saying? Though? Australia, I get.
Yeah.
Once I've been, you know, New Zealand is like, I didn't need the extra flight for that.
I think it'd be easy if you got to fly business class as well, because giving yourself a
way. You haven't been upgraded?
Not to Australia, but to the Middle East, and that just ruined the flight back.
Yeah.
Really?
Who was it? Just a comic that I didn't know well, but again, you're on a foreign trip, so you're like, Simon Evans, who's like, hello, I'm a fucking Tory dad. But as soon as his boy's on tour, he's a great laugh. We got a Gulf Air. They were like, oh, we're going to upgrade you. He was like, fucking spot on. He looked like he'd been upgraded every flight of his life. I look like the bell end who shouldn't be there. But he acted like how you and Carl would act. He was like, oh, fuck, there's free cake. Just kept eating cake. And then he watched a Bollywood film from start to finish. And I was sat next to him. I was like, are you watching a Bollywood film? He was like, it's absolutely fucking mental. It was great fun. We went, we did a Forces gig. And on the way back, we were both like, please upgrade us again. Please upgrade. Because when you've flown like 72 hours before, business class, the thought of going like in the
back
fucking
the
bus and it was the time of year where everyone had been going to Mecca, and so it was the Mecca
bingo,
the Mecca crew,
the famous Saudi Arabian Mecca. There was some fucking big crowds for that bingo. So there's something called what's it called, Mecca flu.
Get
or
it right.
Something. Yeah. I think it's called foreign something. I think it's called Mecca flu, where all these Muslims from around the world come and bring their fucking coughs and splutters and colds into one space. Then they're at the Mecca, and then they do the fucking walking around the thing, the bingo.
Oh, the cabal, yeah.
Yeah, the cabal, yeah, nice one. Someone's worked for Vice. And then go around, and they literally just give each other the cough, and on the flight back, it was the so far from the, we're eating cake, we're watching Bollywood films, we're lying back. It was just me surrounded by a load of Muslim people coughing like fuck. It was horrible. It was just, it just ruined the flight back. Yeah. That you're looking at me like I'm saying something terrible. Yeah. I can feel. Yeah. Don't you try and cancel me, motherfucker.
I'm just, yeah. I'm just
are
wondering
you
why.
With a cough or Muslims?
Yeah, yeah, the that's Muslims. What... that's what I'm saying. You want to be?
It sounds like if it was white people coughing, you go okay.
Yeah,
well,
yeah,
Muslims
cough.
You said the word Muslims so much there that it was like that was part of the problem.
Like we get no Muslims.
Not all of it. It was just it was weighing on your mind.
Bloody Muslims coughing.
We're gonna. Can we go back?
You don't get this at Lord's. Carla, there's no fucking Lord's fountain flu.
I'll give you a clean edit. There's just loads of really good people, and I felt like there was great diversity. Carry on.
Carl, have you got anything? You got any features?
The fuck do we follow? And the ode to comedy.
Yeah, I have. Hang on. Sorry. Right. So this is from Keenan. It's following on from the sleep eating, sleep walking thing. Remember what we did a couple weeks ago?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I don't
doing stuff anything. When you sleep. Okay,
you really have an amazing like. It's a kind of a skill, isn't it?
Once I'm done with an episode, once I leave today, I will forget everything we've spoken about.
Yeah,
and then people write in like, "Do you remember when you talked about that rabbit that you ran over when you were 7?" Like, oh,
it's 8 days ago.
So he said basically, him and his missus have found out he's got sexomnia. So like insomnia, but sexomnia.
Is that a real thing?
I don't know.
That sounds like an excuse.
I think it does. Sounds like a...
go on, hang on, so saying? What's he saying?
Sex on... Like, yeah. Insomnia is you can't sleep.
Let me read it.
We're basically... while we're while we're both asleep, I'll wake up, in quotation marks, start playing with my missus and wake her up and have sex. Okay, so he wakes her up, they have sex.
First of all, sound missus, by the way.
Normal sex. Not on funky, he said. But then he'll fall asleep and wake up in the morning and not remember.
Wow. Right.
So he has like sleep sex. He says, for context, we found out, she said, last night was amazing and he hasn't got a fucking clue what she's going on about. I didn't know what you say about this, but I thought it'd be an interesting, funny topic.
Sexomnia. It's actually, it sounds like he's not doing a bit. It sounds like he's genuinely going, this is a thing.
Yeah.
So what's the question?
It isn't a question.
Oh.
So it's just a follow-up on sleep eating.
Oh.
So he sleeps. He sleep fucks.
Is it possible that like you sort of wake up a little bit, have a horn, have sex, but then go back to sleep straight after?
To have no memory of it.
That's the strange part, isn't it?
Also, it make cub camp really fucking dangerous, wouldn't it? Like,
tent
B got a bit rapey. Mm.
Do you reckon like a nonce could get off of this? Like, you know, if he was on trial,
sleep noncing.
Just like hard. Sleep noncing. I don't remember it. So
would that happen with like?
Would people, he pass a lie detector?
People killed. People in their sleep and have not got off with it, but like been put into like mental institutions and shit.
What, got manslaughter?
Yeah.
Sleep murder?
Yeah, someplace in America. I don't know, sleep nonsense, I don't know.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, would that stand up in
court?
Have
you seen The Fall?
No.
Is it about sleep nonsense?
It should be.
Because that should be made.
It's your serial killer.
We just had
sleep
a pitch
meeting.
We just had a big pitch meeting right now. Sleep nonsense.
Yeah, because I'll be honest, I'm probably not going to get the travel show where I get to go to Mecca. I think that's now off the table.
It's a serial killer who kills loads of women and then loses his memory. And they're like, should he be tried or not?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
He should.
Oh, mate, he's got no recollection. No, let him go.
Say he's got no capacity to defend himself.
Doesn't matter. Well, he did do it.
He shouldn't be free, though, should he?
No, but that's not how trials work, is it?
He shouldn't be free, though, just because you can't remember something.
Totally, but the argument is we can't argue that we didn't do it because I can't fucking remember if I did or not.
No, you can't do that.
It's like me going down the pub and having too many and it's like, oh, there's 10 people killed. Ah, I was pissed, innit? And everyone goes, yeah, all right. Fucking
I always like, that fifth pint, I always go with fucking, that's insane. Of course he should be tried.
It is a TV show.
Yeah, of course it is.
But I feel like it sounds quite dangerous, fucking people in your sleep without remembering, though.
Oh, consent.
Yeah, it sounds.
It does sound like he's waking her up and she's a bit of a horn dog and she's like, I'll fucking game for anything, me.
Yeah, she comes out of this story looking like an absolute champ.
Well, hopefully what do you reckon would happen if you did this
to Laura?
To Laura? First of all, I'd have to sleepwalk from my room in the spare room to her bed. So already she'd be suspicious. And then she's 14 weeks pregnant, so I don't think it'd go well. I'd have to get over her pregnancy pillow and then round her fucking like, and then be like, babe. And then I think is then I'd get an elbow to the face.
What about like if she wasn't preggers though? Not and you're not trying, it's just general time. The kid's 5 now, Etta's 21.
Right.
Some fucking yo,
whacking numbers out here, aren't you? I'm a time traveller.
Yeah.
She's Doctor Who.
But you're in bed together, you've slept together because one of you's...
It has happened. Yeah. It has happened where...
What? You've...
In the night, I've just woken up and I've been like, God, I fucking love her. The thing is, when you really love someone, you like the fucking smell of them, don't you? I know that sounds a bit aggressive, but when you're lying next to your missus, you're like, oh, fucking come here.
It's pheromones and chemicals and shit. But they say that like there's a certain point of the night where your testosterone's the highest, so you probably have a highest. It's like why you wake up with a hard dick is because your testosterone's higher in the morning. So that's why you wake up with a boner.
Because you've had a suppression of it in the night and then it's...
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. I don't know about suppression, but I know that that's the reason you get a boner in the morning is because of your testosterone levels. And that's me being very basic.
No, yeah, it's
I don't
true.
Know.
I same with alcohol. Yeah. Same with alcohol. If you don't get a boner, like alcohol suppresses your testosterone.
Oh, okay, okay.
So when you know when you're hungover the morning, you feel horny. It's because you've had so long of your testosterone being suppressed. And then you're in your most rancid state, like, fucking, you've got like, I just want to bang something and no one wants to even look at you.
How often do you get fucking morning?
Most mornings.
What? Yeah, most mornings.
Most mornings, yeah, Dan.
Most mornings. Right now. Fuck off.
Sometimes. How old are you? My age, isn't
28.
It? Yeah, so we're still at our peak of testosterone. How old are you?
104.
104.
How old are you?
29.
29.
Yeah.
Hey, can we fire the question on him, the 50 quid or the...
Oh, yes.
All right.
Oh.
Very excited.
Mate, touche today. Touche.
I nearly did it. So would you rather right every morning when you wake up you get 50 quid or every morning when you wake up you get a blowjob? No questions asked, you don't have to do anything, you just get to lay back and enjoy it.
Who's giving me the blowjob?
So the caveat dream was woman. Your dream woman comes into your room, she either gives you a blowjob or she gives you £50
and it's firehead.
It's and also like you, I know you're in a relationship but for some reason your girlfriend's just fine with it.
It's a part of the thing.
I'll show her this clip. Like, baby, sort it out. Right? This is
50 I'm just quid cash. You know,
if this potential happens.
So what are you taking?
I'll probably take the blowjob.
Yes!
It's 18 grand a year, though.
How much?
£18,000 a year.
Yeah, but
tax free.
But
every morning.
But then as well as, do I have, because it might be a morning I'm just not in the mood.
No, see.
Oh, no, she's still
bing bong. It's you either have the blowjob forever or the money forever. You can't go today.
And if I have £50, can I still get blowjobs?
Yeah.
Oh, I'll take the £50 then, because I can still get blowjobs. I would want to say I get there.
Yes, fuck off, Adam.
Right answer.
There you go.
Yeah. I don't think you ever wait. I've never like been receiving a blowjob and being like, I wish this wasn't happening.
No. But have you never been in the mood for like, for whatever reason, you might have had a shit day or whatever and you're just not in the mood to have sex? Or have you, are you always in the mood?
Not in the morning though.
Are you always ready to go in the morning?
Yeah.
Every morning. Every morning.
Yeah.
Hungover.
More
feeling ill.
Yeah, more say hungover.
So you get COVID, right? You're like, oh God, it's really heavy on my chest and fucking, I should have taken it more serious. Coronavirus. Bing bong. Here comes fucking dream girl. Like, don't give a shit. You said a blowjob.
But then, I don't know if I'm leaning the other way.
Who's your dream girl, Jamali? Like celebrity or actress or?
Do you know what? I've gone through so many phases.
Who's your current face?
Who's your current face?
I don't know. Do you know what? I don't really know pop culture.
Yeah.
So
you don't have to. You could be like.
No. But I understand what you're saying, but right. I don't know.
The Queen, circa 1953.
I don't really know pop culture enough to throw a name of reference, to be honest
with you.
Or
Kat Dealey or Misty from Pokemon. They were my two.
Was that a question for Misty? Who's not Misty? Is that one with the big lips?
No, she's Ash's boy. Ash's mate. Like the.
I think she's like 14, mate.
The water trainer. Yeah, she was then. Pokemon's old now, like. Right,
you're not even asleep. You
invest early. He's like, I see potential.
She was also a cartoon. What? She was also a cartoon.
Oh, there's nothing wrong with that.
Imagination, you fucking idiot.
Who's like the
people my age, Helen Mirren.
But who's the
banging?
Who's like the big babes right now though? Like, I don't know what's
Margot
the...
Robbie.
Who?
Margot Robbie.
Nah, she's about 33 though, isn't she?
Yeah.
What about that?
Do you know, is that too young or too old?
Nah, I'm just saying, surely there's like hotter, younger.
Stop being so ageist. Oh, you're disgusting at times, you know.
I don't
I don't know any like younger ones really.
Margot Robbie's mad. Okay.
I can't believe anyone can look at a picture of Margot Robbie and go.
No. See, these are different. There's a real difference though, yeah. And this is, I think, of preference, right? Is I can appreciate she's beautiful, but I don't know if she's like.
No, she's not.
Oh. Do you see what I'm saying? There's a difference.
Wolf of Wall Street did her the world of good.
There's women that are not. You go to Sweden, you go, wow, they're beautiful women, but they're very clinical. There's no.
Oh, okay. You know?
Are you like a little edge?
An edge?
He likes that.
Okay, I summed up like this. I like a late afternoon to an early evening stripper. I think that's the best time. Do you see what I'm saying? Like a late afternoon to an early evening.
You're not bothered about Saturday night headliners.
No. So it's like, it's not a cheap lap dance, but it's affordable. And I think that's the peak.
Yeah. You want the one that's had to sort out childcare to get tits out.
Yeah.
Like, Dan likes them to look like his porn searches are not like classical. He's sort of on the same vibe. You like to look like they might not have brushed their teeth or something.
Genuinely, I'd like to find my porn on like Facebook Marketplace. I'm like, I want some realism.
We've
got a fucking cabinet to sell and look at Jill's tits.
Like, I think there is something attractive about a realness and reality, because I think some of these, you know, sort of women that are sort of look fake is kind of like, but I'm never going to see that in reality.
Yes.
I'm saying,
less. That's what I'm about.
And I think there's a difference between, you know, beautiful. This is some
like attainable.
No, it's like attainable. It's that thing of like, because like
beautiful and sexy are different.
Yes, beautiful and sexy are two different things.
Also, the supermodels are aesthetically pleasing.
Yes,
but Scarlett Johansson is stunning. She's got an amazing figure and she's incredibly talented.
Like, who's that?
There's more going on.
Who's that? Who's the Latino actress?
Sorry, Eva Mendes.
Eva Mendes.
She was my first.
That was a valid point.
What happened?
He's just ripping the shit out of me.
What do you say?
For being a nonce.
It was like you were talking about someone you're in love with. He went, you know, all these supermodels are amazing, but Scarlett Johansson is beautiful and she's really talented.
Yeah, I was a bit.
Shout out.
Yeah.
Margot Robbie is attractive, but she's a bit rough. She looks like you could see her in the fucking Runcorn Asda with trackies on. She's got a bit scally about her.
I just think she's very clinical. She's very. You go like, oh, yeah.
Do you like Eva Mendes then, yeah?
Yeah.
She was my first.
Like, she's, I think Eva Mendes is like, you look at Eva and go, God, that. Like, she's not maybe as like what you would, you know, if you had a scientific graph of what pretty is in terms of symmetrical face. Not having beauty spots, but she's sexy.
My first
you know
one.
What I'm saying? That's the point I'm making.
She's a lesbian, actually, is the girl from SWAT. Have you seen the film SWAT?
No.
Colin Farrell.
Oh, you've seen it? That classic.
It's not Colin Farrell.
It is Colin Farrell?
Yeah.
What's
her name?
Lena Esco.
Let's see. That doesn't sound
Do you know what my absolute favorite? Bobby Mare.
She got like a bald head?
No.
Is it Stephanie Sigmund?
No, she's like Colombian or something.
Yeah, are we doing Wank Bank now?
Lena Esco sounds very South American, doesn't it?
No, it's not here.
Oh, God. This is fire, this bit. As we Google fucking
it is
Adam, women.
It is. I know what you mean.
It's not Lena Esco.
Well, you don't know who it is.
How you doing, mate? You all
right? Yeah,
talk amongst yourselves.
Mate, this one has hit the height, like all episode, and then we've just slightly gone off the rails at the end.
As Michelle like, Rodriguez.
She's
in Fast and the Furious.
Yeah, Fast and Furious.
Fast and Furious.
Oh, wait, anyway,
she seemed like she would be in SWAT, though, to be
fair. Can you pop her up? Carl, on the video, just so people get the satisfaction of knowing.
Yeah.
She's attractive.
Yeah. I'm in love with her.
She'd smash your head in air as well.
Yeah. She's batty.
Like, you wouldn't get it back.
Yeah.
Should we call that a pod? Because that has been...
Let's call this a podcast.
It's been a beauty. Jamali, that has been phenomenal.
Okay.
I've loved that.
It's been very, very good.
Have you had any shit ones, though?
Yeah, we've had a couple.
Okay,
yeah,
cool.
Yeah, we'll tell you.
We'll tell you once that camera goes off and
great.
Button goes green. If you really enjoy this stuff, there's an extra episode every single week on patreon.com/haveawordpod. We've got new merch coming soon. Go and check Jamali out everywhere. It's Jamali Maddix, Jamali Maddix. Did I nail that?
Yep. And oh, I've got a podcast coming out where I'm recording it with my friend in prison.
Okay.
What?
So he's in prison and I'm going to record a podcast. So that's going to come out this
Boring.
Year.
Boring. Yeah. Boring.
That's going to be this year.
That's going to be amazing. What are you calling it? Do you know?
No, we ain't worked out the name yet, but it's going to be out this year.
Call it Reverse Charge.
Oh, pitch me in. Oh, I like
that. That's actually really good, though.
That's not a bad one.
Thank you. Well, that makes up for the Muslim racism.
Bye, Felicia.
Bye, Felicia.
What's happening, guys? Today's sponsor is beer52.com. They are the UK's number one craft beer discovery club.
And they've teamed up with us to give our listeners a free case of beer.
That means you get 8 free beers, an award-winning beer magazine, and a tasty snack as your first free order.
And it's free. You pay nothing. You just pay the £5.95 postage and packaging.
You'll then be a member of their Craft Beer Discovery Club, and they send you a different theme of beers every month. Past themes have been the beers of Belgium, the beers of Korea, California, all over the world. Every month, a new theme, and they're always a belter.
You'll find craft beers that you'll never find on your own. And also, you can pause your membership at any time.
So do us a favour, support the podcast, support our sponsors. Go to beer52.com/word. That's beer52.com/WORD.
Every time you sign up, we get a little bit of money. So you get your free beers. There's a little bit of money to support the podcast. It's win-win. I'm a member. I love it.
Let's get back to the podcast. But go and get some beers. Pause it here. Go and get some beers.
Beer52.